In primary school?
Yes. First, it starts. It must start at the primary school. Then it has to continue on in other class. Yes, you are asking, what is the main idea of the story? They are reading and you are asking, what is the main idea of the story?
Yeah.
So, you can illustrate a movie and you can ask, what is the main idea of the movie? Okay?
Yeah, I think we did.
So many people don't know how to make a comment about visual images.
Mm.
You came here and actually you didn't have an idea. You were thinking that watching movie was entertainment, just entertainment. I am not against entertainment. Don't misunderstand me. Because while you are reading the storybooks or novel, you are getting entertainment as well. But entertainment and also other functions can be side by side. Okay? What I want to say is this. So today, is it turning on? Huh, okay, it is working. Today, today we will talk about Deleuze, Gilles Deleuze, and the possibilities of cinema. I can give some examples about these topics. From the beginning, I have been mentioning about Gilles Deleuze. Gilles Deleuze was a cinema philosopher. He has two books, Cinema 1, Cinema 2. They are about cinema philosophy. If you want to make a connection between cinema and philosophy, you should learn the idea of Gilles Deleuze. But it is very highly intellectual issue. I just want to summarize of his main idea. First of all, we should ask this question. Why does Deleuze pay attention to movie? Why does Deleuze, Gilles Deleuze, pay attention to movie? Why did a philosopher, Gilles Deleuze, like Gilles Deleuze, write a book, Cinema 1 and Cinema 2, during 1980s. So what did he discover in cinema? So in order to search for the nature of cinema, we need to ask these questions. Actually, his basic question is about thought. Is about thought. In our age, as philosopher Heidegger put it, we are creatures who are supposed to think, but in fact, we are not thinking. Heidegger claims that we are supposed to think, but we are not thinking. And we mix opinion up with the thought. Gilles Deleuze argues that thought has three modes of appearances. What are they? Art, science, and philosophy. According to Deleuze, philosophy works with concepts. Philosophy invents or creates concepts. This is very important. I am not talking about repeating concepts. I am not talking about using or getting some concepts and to use these concepts in other area. Philosophy invents or creates concepts. This is very basic point of Gilles Deleuze. Okay? It is one of way thought. Art. What is art? Art often works sense. Affection, emotion, and sense are artworks with sense. Science. What about science? Science works by functions, equations, coordinates. Deleuze never puts them in a hierarchical order. Never. Deleuze never puts them in a hierarchical order. They are just different modes of thought. They are just different modes of thought. You know, there is a thought over there, okay? And it divides, it is divided under three modes. And one of them is science, the other is philosophy, the other is art. Philosophy works with concepts and creates concepts, invades concepts. Art works sense, and science works by functions, equations, coordinates. And there is no hierarchy between them, okay? Every mode is equal with each other. All of them are essential. All of them are essential. Intellect, senses or emotions, as well as functions and equations, they need each other. They need each other. Sometimes some people can claim that what is important is science. Other people can claim that probably they are dealing with art. They claim that art is the highest point of thought. They can claim like this. And also, you know, philosophers, some philosophers may argue that what is important is to evaluate the concepts of philosophy. Philosophy is the primary mode, is the highest primary mode of the thought. They can claim it. But Deleuze, actually, I agree with Deleuze. Deleuze is against this idea. Deleuze says that they are equal each other. Okay? Equal each other. And why is cinema important for Deleuze? This is the another question. Because according to Deleuze, cinema is produced with images, whereas philosophy works by concepts. Therefore, a cinema director actually is a person who thinks with images. So, at this point we can claim that a cinema director is as much as important a philosopher and scientist. A director who thinks with images is as important as a philosopher who thinks with concepts. They are equal. So that is why a philosopher cannot dominate cinema. You know, some philosophers can claim that I have a reflection on cinema. I can make a philosophy about images in cinema. Okay? He can claim this idea, but Deleuze is against this comment. He says that any philosopher or no philosopher cannot make a comment about cinema or images. They can classify images. Philosophers can classify images, and also they can think the concept of cinema rather than cinema. Can you understand the difference between them? I mean, philosopher cannot think on cinema, can think on the concept of cinema. There is a difference between them, okay? At the end of the cinema two book, Deleuze adds something new. This expression is essential for me, I think, the Deleuze expression. Yes, in cinema there are some ideas, whereas in philosophy there are concepts. In philosophy there are concepts, in cinema there are some ideas. Hereafter we need to ask this question. How does cinema make a contribution to philosophy? How does cinema contribute to philosophy? Philosophers say that how can philosophy can contribute to cinema? Deleuze reverses this question and say that how can cinema contribute to philosophy? I hope you can understand the paradox. And many people think that it is against the common sense. But when you deal with cinema, you can understand the Deleuze point. I showed many examples about this topic. And in the future lessons, I will enlarge the details of the topic by some illustrations. So this is a very vital question. How does cinema contribute to philosophy? So we don't mention the contribution of philosophy to the cinema any longer. On the contrary, to create a concept in philosophy, we call for cinema. We are asking cinema help to create concept in philosophy. Remember, I illustrated some love scenes, love. Do you remember? Love, about the topic of love. I illustrated many movie scenes. Love.
The couple that traveled to Italy, the mm-hmm. crucified lovers.
Yes. And also, Before Midnight.
Before Midnight, yes.
And also Voyage to Italy. Journey to Italy. When we are watching movie, we can get some questions from these images. We can get some ideas from the movies. And so it is a contribution to philosophy. It is a contribution to philosophy. Philosophy cannot say like this, love is a miracle. Philosophy doesn't say like this. But in cinema, you can see the love concept, love idea like this. Love is a miracle. Love is an event. So by watching movies, you can understand this idea. This is the contribution of cinema to philosophy. Okay. In the last lecture, I will touch this issue in detail, and I am going to think about what kinds of contribution of cinema may provide to philosophy in the last lesson, okay? In the last week. So discussing this issue, Deleuze, impressed by Henri Bergson, makes a separation between images as time images and movement images. I am sure you have forgotten these issues. That is why I am also repeating and make a summarization about this topic. Cinema began as movement image, but after the Second World War, after the Second World War, because of the disappearance of agents, the decreasing effect of the heroic stories, the crisis of humanity, the crisis of action, the crisis of the existence of the world, caused the appearance of a new image. It is time image. It is time image. Remember, what was the movement image? Movement image was in connection with the action. you perceive some things outside, and according to this perception, you act in accordance with the perception. There is a coordination between your perception and action. But you know, before the Second World War, the world was designed according to action. People were fighting with each other, and also you are creating a different image in line with the action. But after the Second World War, people understood that action could damage to the world, and rather than action, we should take a rest. We should create new methods of behaving. So in cinema, in Italian New Realism, another kind of image appeared, and its name is time image. So what is it? Let's remember it. For Deleuze, time image presents time directly, and provides us with some signs of emerging society. It can show a new and creative society as well. Because when we think over indeterminacy and, you know, virtue, at the same time we can be aware of forks in the future too. When you think over indiscernible things, unexpected things, and indeterminacy and virtue, you can make a fork in the future. Okay. In order to illustrate how time image works, let me show a scene from The Silent Light. It is directed by Carlos Reygadas, a Mexican director. So I just want to show the beginning part of the movie. Okay, time image. This is the beginning of the movie, and it shows time directly, not indirectly. While watching, you can understand why my point. Thank you. This is time image. So you are sleeping.
No.
It is different, eh? Why? Because you should wait for its opening. For, you know, you are waiting for a cut or editing. But it doesn't suit you because it doesn't, you know, it is unexpected images are continuing.
It's like we are transit from the night to the morning.
So I want to ask a question, like, why did this director feel the need to put up such a scene in the beginning of a movie, or actually put it in the movie? Like, what message is he trying to pass around?
You can create your fork. There can be another possibility in life. You should take a rest. You should feel the time directly. You know, there are two kinds of time, according to Bergson and also Deleuze. Chronological time, like clock time. And you can divide this time as much as you could, you know. If you think time like this, you are just obeying the rules of the time or society or the, you know, power. You think that life is like this, and you take over the life as it is, you know. But with the time image, you can feel the time in another way, and you should wait for some things to happen. This is Bergson example. Probably I gave an example before, but I am not sure. There is a glass of tea, for example. There is a glass of tea, and you can put sugar, a cube sugar, into the tea, and either you are stir with the spoon, or you should wait for, you know, dissolving of the sugar. While you are waiting, you can change. You are changing. You can be impatient or patient person. Your duration is far different. Your duration is different, you know. But while I am waiting, I can be patient, but probably you can be impatient. Your duration is different from my duration. And also you can depend on a glass of tea. You should wait for it. And also while you are waiting, there are some change inside the tea, because the water, you know, the sugar is dissolving, and after a while you can face you know, sugared tea. So it means that everything is dependent on each other, and in the life there is a relation rather than one type of thing. There are some kind of relations, and you can invent different kinds of relations. Now that everything has different duration, now that your duration is different from others, but also, you know, you can be aware of the fact that there is not one kind of duration. Your duration is different from others. You can feel other durations. The water's duration, the tea's duration, the sugar's duration is different from each other. In the life, inanimate objects have their durations, and also peoples have different durations. So you can create another path, another fork in the life. You can feel the difference between them. Okay? That is why time image is important. And also, We think that life is rational. By saying rational, you think that your ratio, your intellect comes to 4. But sometimes if your motor sensory scheme, collapses, you can make a difference in the life. Remember, movement image. What was the movement image? Your motor sensory scheme works in line with your perception. Okay, an action. This is expected behavior. But what if your motor sensory scheme collapses? And what if you can behave in a different way? This is time image. This is time image. Time image shows us this. This duration is outside of chronological time, and it can be flexible, like plastic. Plastic. It is opening. It is opening, and you should wait for its opening.
Actually, I felt like when I was watching the video, I felt like I was being choked. I don't know how to explain. You know when you are expecting something to happen, but it's not happened. It keeps on.
Your motor sensors come and collapses.
Yes, I kept on. So I was running out of breath because I was waiting for it to maybe just cut somewhere. And, oh, okay, I'm going to take a deep breath. But it just kept on taking me like that. And that's why you saw, like, at the end of the video, I was like, as if I was sleeping.
Yes, good. You can feel the trouble. You can feel the, you are bored with watching this scene because it is long. It is long shot. There is no cut. And so that is why your motor sensory scheme collapses. And if your motor sensory scheme collapses, you start to think. Okay? I hope you got my point.
Yeah. But for me, it was a little bit different because when the scene began, I was confused. Before, I saw the sky, and then in my mind, it was like a forest.
Yes.
I didn't.
You are thinking.
Yeah, I didn't recognize what was it.
So?
It was a sky or a forest with trees. And in the morning, something like red comes up, and then I start to understand that it was the sky because I was seeing the light coming and I see the tree. So
you make an effort.
Yeah.
You make an effort to understand the image. So that is why this is time image.
And it's true what you said. You can pinpoint a life lesson from this video we just watched. Like, it's somewhat like patience here. And the more you resist, the more better things unfold in whatever endeavor you are doing. Like what he said before, we saw like a beginning, then something better came up, then it got better, then now we have a better picture of our struggle or something like that. I don't know, maybe that's a message the person is trying to pass through in that place.
This is a different movie, and you cannot forget this image later. You can imagine this later, or you can recollect this image while you are walking and outside. You cannot finish the movie. You cannot finish the image in the movie. After the movie, you can remember, you can recollect. Your memory comes to fore. And that is why these images are very essential for creating new thoughts, new thinkings, okay? Probably in your dream you can recollect this memory, this image, sorry. So it shows the time image. Why is it important for us? And let me repeat it. Because we don't have any idea What virtual emerge in new fork, new paths? I am saying virtual. Do you know virtual?
But we can see.
Virtual, you know, today many people are using this expression in line with the computers.
Mm-hmm.
And they are saying virtual media or virtual area, virtual environment. What do you understand by saying virtual? It is not real, huh?
Yeah.
It is not actual. Actually, in philosophy, in Bergson, and also in Deleuze, virtual is the part of reality, is the part of actuality. It is very highly intellectual issue, but I can make a summarization of it, probably. This discussion started in Aristo, you know, Aristo. Aristo makes a separation between potentiality and actuality. Potentiality and actuality. What does it mean? Actuality, you know, actuality is the real thing, and when you do some things, it is actual. But everything conveys the potentiality inside it. There can be some kind of potentiality inside everything. For example, you have a seed, you know, seed, and you are planting.
Mm-hmm.
You are planting this seed to the soil, okay? And after a while, you know, it can be flower, you know? It is flourishing. When we see the seed, actually we understand that there is a potentiality of flower inside the seed, but we cannot see now.
Mm-hmm.
Aristotle makes a separation between potentiality and actuality. But during the Middle Ages, there were two philosophers who dealt with this issue. They took this concept, potentiality, and they worked them and discussed the meaning of it. They used another term, virtual and actual separation. Virtual and actual. Rather than using potential, they applied virtual, okay? Thomas Aquinas and also another philosopher, Don Scotus. They dealt with this issue. Let me give an example. Thomas Aquinas gave an example, as far as I remember. He says that, take a piece of marble, you know. Inside the marble, there is a potential, there is a virtuality of being done sculpture. Yes. So, but it is a sculpture. Heykeltıraş neydi? Sculpture.
Sculpture.
No, sculpture. I think sculpture. Yeah, it is a sculptor who creates this sculpture. Okay. Yes, because there is a little difference, minor difference between them. But in the marble, not only sculpture, but also other kinds of possibilities can be found. You can create this marble another kind of material, another kind of art piece, you know. And there is a virtuality inside the marble. Don Scotus, what is it?
Sculptor.
Sculptor, yes. Don Scotus enlarged this topic, and he says, he uses another term, transcendental. Transcendental. What does it mean? You can say that this is one. It is one. Okay, one. But one and oneness is different from each other. One and oneness. Okay? Oneness is transcendental thing, and one is real thing, you know? So virtuality and actuality separation. I hope you got my point. Oneness and one. So Bergson took these ideas and he worked on the memory. He worked on the memory and discussed the meaning of virtuality and actuality. As far as I remember, he says that there is not separation between actuality and virtuality. I mean, okay, there is a discrepancy between them, but it doesn't mean that virtual thing is not real. Virtuality is also part of the reality. For example, I am asking a question. How was your childhood? How was your childhood? And when I ask this question, you recollect your childhood. Probably you are searching, you know, you are searching childhood memories in your memory. And when you bring some recollection from the childhood, this is the actualization. This is the actual thing. But other childhood memories are in the virtual area in your memory. They are standing there. They are not actual. Probably when I ask another question, you can try to research another piece of memory parts, and you can recollect. And when you recollect, when you remember something, this is the actualization of your childhood memories. Did you get it? It is highly difficult, even in Turkish, but I am trying to tell in English. But probably you got it. Huh?
Yeah, of course.
Very good.
Yeah, because, you know,
it's good.
I am not sure whether or not in English, even English philosopher can tell this story.
I get the point. With the example of childhood,
I get the point.
Yes. So this is the virtuality and actuality. So, virtuality doesn't mean that virtual thing does not exist. Virtual also exist, but in your memory, okay?
So they can also be actual.
They can be actual. When you recollect,
when you
remember, they can be. So cinema can show this virtuality. Cinema, you know, this is the possibility of cinema. And I'm trying to reinvigorate myself. When you perceive some things, you can act in accordance with your perception. But this is the movement image. Remember my question. What if you cannot behave according to your perception? What is the link? What can you make a link between your perception and other things? At this point, memory comes on. When you perceive some things, you can link this perception with your memory rather than action. Did you get it? This is not movement image. If you perceive some things and if you link this perception with your memory, with your dreams, and with your world movement, it is different. I can explain later. This is a time image. You are perceiving some things, but you cannot behave according to your action.
Perception.
Perception. You are applying your memories. You are applying your dreams. And you are recollect, you are trying to recollect your memories, okay? This is the time image. And cinema can show these things. For example, in cinema, you know, you see some dreams. And dreams can be shown in different way. And also, sometimes you are showing flashbacks. Okay, you are flashbacks. And these flashbacks is like finding some parts of pieces. In another words, for example, a person has died. Charles Foster Kane in Citizen Kane. Charles Foster Kane has died, and after dying, there is a reporter, and he is trying to find some memories of Charles Foster Kane, and he is asking some questions to his friends and other people in order to understand the reality of truth of Charles Foster Kane. But everybody is telling different story, and so you are combining these stories in order to understand the reality of Charles Foster Kane. Okay, you are making an effort. You sometimes get into the one story, one recollection memory, and cinema shows it. And other person, like his wife, is telling another story, and you are, you know, getting together. You are combining this piece of memories in order to understand the reality of Charles Foster Kane. Cinema shows it. This is time image, another type of time image.
So I have also an example. I don't know if it's time image, because when I was a child, my grandfather used to have a perfume. So I had this perfume, I know the smell of this perfume. So many years later, when I was in high school, I feel that perfume.
Good.
And then I had that memories for the last memories.
Good.
And it was like many things was happening in my mind. I was remember all those whole time. And then I buy this perfume.
Yes.
And I start to use it.
Yes. Cinema can show it, your memory. So this is the shining point. In your life, you know, there were many memories. There were many mementos. And but you recollect some shining points. This is the quality moment. This is the distinction moment, distinctive moment. So you find this piece of memory, and cinema can show this memory part. This is not muscular memory. This is not muscular memory. This is not motor memory. This is a shining point in your life. This is time image.
And also before
pure,
I recognize
pure,
the...
Pure memory. It is pure memory. You know, pure.
Before I recognize the smell, it was like a fight. Because when I feel this, I feel the smell, my memory goes. Because I didn't know what was it, but I know that I know this smell. And in my memory, start to work until it find that memory. And then I noticed that, okay, it's that perfume that my grandfather used to
mm-hmm.
use. So it was like a time when I was thinking before I found out.
Yes. So our past is crowding on us, you know. Our past is crowding on us, actually, in fact. And when we face an event or a relation, either we act in accordance with our motor sensory mechanism or schema, or we can, you know, recollect some things recollect some things, and we try to understand the meaning by looking back to our past. And cinema can show this past, so it is not motor sensory mechanism or schema. I hope you understand. So what is the benefit of this? We don't know what the new society will be. We don't know. When we look at the time image, we can get clue that probably the new society will be different from now. There will be a miracle, you know, there will be a miracle, a new hope in the future, probably. Because everything is becoming. In everything, there are different forks. So, unpredictability. Unpredictability is the manifestation of this time, new image. Unpredictability, you know. But when we see Hollywood movies, remember, we can predict the beginning, the progress, and final section. It is not difficult, you know. But when you are watching this time image, a little before I showed, did you guess the becoming or process? No, you couldn't. And you are curious about what will happen. But when you watch a Hollywood movie, you are guessing. Probably your guess is in line with the image. Everything has coordination with each other.
Streamlined.
Huh? Streamlined. Yes, streamlined. Good. So there are lots of cliche images in movement image. Cliche images, cuts and montage, editing, you know. And cliche images become permanent since they have been used a lot in cinema. But time images are new and creative images instead of cliche images. And we don't have an idea of the next shot or scene in the movie. So I think one of the best possibilities of cinema to thought can be this, I think. So remember that cinema, as Deleuze said, means of blocks of movement and time. And time image is different from movement image. But remember, in the movement image as well, we feel time, but indirectly. Direct time image turns out when our motor sensory schema collapses. Don't forget it. And normally we perceive objects and act appropriately with this perception. This is normal response of human being. Okay? When you perceive something and appropriately you act with this perception. This is normal perception, normal response of human being, So between perception and action, remember, there is affection. Affection, what was the affection? Bodily change, bodily symptoms, feeling, emotion. So before action, our shoulders may drop, or our face can blush, probably. Movement image involves perception images, action images, and affection images, okay? But sometimes our memory can fill the gap or interval between perception and action. At this moment, we search our past sheaths and recollect some things. Can cinema show these recollections? and layers of sheets. There are some layers of sheets, you know, in our past. There are different layers of sheets. There are some locations. In one sheet, there can be similar things. Childhood, for example, or youth, in your youth, maybe there is another sheet. Maybe primary school, another sheet. There are difference of sheets, layers of sheets. Cinema also shows us our dreams, and rather than acting on some things, we dream. Dreams are another kind of time image. In cinema, there is also another technique of which shows time image: flashbacks and flash forwards. So we feel time directly thanks to these techniques. Let me elaborate on this. When we perceive some things, sometimes memory does not provide us with an automatic connection. At this moment, we have to do something more deliberate. We should try to recollect something that has happened in the past. It is going to help us in the present. Why are we recollecting these things? Because it can be help. It can help to us now, present. This is a further level still at which memory works. This is pure memory. Yes, this is pure memory. We can access pure memory by a particular placing, particular act of placing ourselves in the past. We usually recollect some particularly significant moment, some shining point or a theme, you know. Shining points in our life. There were some shining points. This is pure memory. Pure memory. You gave an example. You said that during high school years, I used a perfume.
No, when I was a kid.
When you were a kid, sorry.
My grandfather used a perfume.
Okay.
In high school, I remember.
High school, you. This is the shining moment. Shining moment. This is the pure memory, and so you remember. You remember the perfume used by during your childhood. So once we are there back in the past, we can then extend the links to other memories. To other memories located in the same level of the past. I mean, when you were a kid, you were going to primary school, and there were different memories in your mind. And actually, during this time, I mean, during the primary school years, there were different layers of there were different sheets of layers. Okay, so when you try to recollect some things about this period, you push yourself in one location, and moment. And when you get some recollection during this layer, you can extend this memory to other memories. You can make a link between memories. Okay? And we could do this fully, and we would be able to recapture all of our former past life. So this is the important point. We get close to living in pure memory when the demands of the present are minimized. When the demands of present are minimized, are minimized. We get close to living in pure memory. Okay? So remember, it is pragmatic life. Present is in connection with pragmatic life. And when the present demands are minimized, we can recollect pure memory a lot. Okay? So, cinema can show it beyond the pragmatic life. And the most common occurrence of this presence of pure memory is when we dream. When we dream, we can get away from the present demands. So cinema can show our dreams. And there are some movies, there are many movies about this topic. These are time images. But let me make a separation about dream scenes or sequences. In Hollywood movies as well, you can witness some dream sequences, But in Hollywood movie, when you dream, you can understand what the reality is, what the dream is. But in time image, everything is, you know, blurred. It is, yeah, how can I say? You cannot make a distinction. What the reality is, what the dream is. So this is a time image. There is an indistinction between them. Did you get my point? This is the pure time image. So film is going to have to show us how memories operate. But the movement image shows the automatic link between bodily memories and action. But recollection and its connections with pure memory also need to be shown. So one way to do this is via dream sequences. Memory has a major influence on what we do in present. Memory always crowds in on us and our perceptions and feelings. It exerts pressure, most obviously through automatic recollection. But the other levels of memory influence us too, although we might not be so aware of it. We act automatically, almost like objects, when we display habitual movements. But we feel at our most subjective when we are back in the past, exploring our memories. And however, my very subjectivity, my personality is the result of duration. Duration is what produces subjectivity. We live in and through duration. I mean, we live in duration. And memories are in duration. Duration. You can think duration is like an analogy between fish and sea. Fish, you know, is under the sea and swimming in the sea. And the sea is duration. Duration is covering everything. And our memory is as well is in duration. Okay? Okay, and one more thing about our duration. So, I mean, when you ask a question about your experience, you can answer the question by using your actual experiences, actual your real experiences. So we think of our experiences in real way. But it is clear that things need not have happened in the way they did. Things need not have happened in the way they did. I could have chosen to go to another university. I could have chosen to go abroad. You could have, have gone another university, probably. I could have a different job, there is a possibility. I could have another partner, another marriage, another kid. There is a whole set of possibilities. There is a whole set of possibilities. But only some of which have been realized. Again, so the same applies to animals and objects as well. So, this is the Deleuze explanation. A proper philosophical account of duration takes these into account. In Deleuzian terms, duration is a multiplicity, a cluster of related, but different possibilities. Did you get it? A cluster of related, but different possibilities. It is multiplicity. So some get realized, realized, while others remain as virtual.
Sorry, can you come again? Duration is?
Another kind of meaning of duration.
Okay.
This is multiplicity, a cluster of related things, but different possibilities. So some get realized. Remember, when you recollect some childhood memories, these are actuals. These are actuals, but you actualize your memories. But it doesn't mean that the past just only comprises with your recollection. And also there are some other past memories inside your memory. When you need, they can appear. They are virtual. And some things remain as virtual, something remains as virtual. And you came here to join the class, but you could have gone to other places. You could have, gotten together with your friends, come together with your friend. There could have been different possibilities of you, but you came here, you realized, you actually sighed. So this is the duration. So cinema can show us these virtualities or potentials, okay? In real life, you cannot be aware of these potentials, virtualities. But cinema can show us these virtualities, okay? This is the one kind of possibility of cinema. And this is the contribution of cinema to philosophy as well. You can write, you can think, but by encountering with the images, you can feel the duration, you can feel time directly, not indirectly. So there is a movie director whose name is Kieślowski. He is Poland. He's from Poland. He's a Polish film director. And his movies are based upon these conceptions. And I suggest that You can watch, for example, Blind Chance, and Double Life of Veronica. And I strictly recommend that you should watch Three Colors trilogy. Three Colors Blue, Three Colors Red, Three Colors White. Blue, white, and red. The last one is red. So there are different types of time images. Orson Welles' film Citizen Kane shows us sheets of past very clearly. I mentioned before, characters, you know, there are some characters. Characters are asked to recall Kane, and they jump back into regions of the past. They jump back into the regions of the past. So Citizen Kane, the movie, I mean, shows a series of events. We can see these sheets do not correspond exactly with each other. They are not convenient with each other. They don't agree with each other, you know. These sheets cannot be organized as more or less close to some agreed truth about Kane. In cinema, so I can finish this subject now. In cinema, it is the virtual image crystallizing into an actual optical image, a simultaneous double, as Deleuze calls it, crystal image. A crystal image is one which is capable of showing both the virtual and the actual. It can be complex, but I hope you may understand my point. If you show an image both in actual and virtual way, indiscernibility comes to fore. You cannot discern what the actual is, what the virtual is. This is the crystal image, double.
Do we have an example for that?
Okay, I can give an example, but be patient, maybe be 1 or 2 minutes later.
Okay.
So the easiest case is mirror, you know, mirror, where the image in the mirror reflects an actual character. When you look at the mirror, you can see yourself in the mirror, but then becomes actual itself, takes on a life on its own. We cannot distinguish the mirror image and the character. You have an interview for a job, okay? You get up and you check your appearance in the mirror before you set up. You want to make sure you look like a proper candidate, okay? Then it is the candidate that actually leaves the house while the person stays behind. While the person stays behind, you got up, you washed your face and hands and face, and you check your appearance in the mirror, okay? And after leaving your house, The person who gets up stays behind. The candidate goes on his own way. So, what is the real? What is the virtual? Okay, let me show an movie scene which tells the this point. Actually, it is Turkish movie. It is Turkish movie. It is Turkish movie. So its Turkish title is Ben O Değil. In English, I am not him. I am not him. There is an ordinary guy who does the same activities every day, and someday he meets a woman, a worker woman, and they get together. They have a relationship between them. They have an affair, and one day he finds the dead body of the woman on the beach. And then, after a while, he sees the same woman in another place. And what is the strangest one is this. He sees himself in another place. Okay? So, you have some contradictory feelings, you know? Which one is true? Which one is wrong? Which one is fake? Which one is real? So I hope you get my point. This is mirror. This is crystal image. Your motor sensory sequence collapses. So when your motor sensory sequence collapses, you start to think. So maybe. This is the irrational thing, you know? This is the irrational thing, and you think that this is the irrational thing. But at the same time, you can understand that there can be different possibility in life. There can be different things in life. So this is the beginning of the movie. I am not in. This is the time image, by the way. You are looking, and you are waiting to be cut, but there is no cut. You see the mirror and the appearance of the guy in the mirror. He's checking out himself. You are surprised. How is it possible? how is it possible to be seen? I mean, how is it possible a guy to be seen on the, in the mirror? But remember my example. This time image or mirror image is about the fork. There can be double. There can be double. Virtual and, you know, actual. And you get, he gets up. He checks his appearance in the mirror. And when you look at the mirror, you change yourself. Because the mirror, you know, how can I say, grasps yourself. Your identity, grasps your identity. And you, you know, you check your appearance, you change your appearance in line with the mirror. You made another person after looking the mirror. And this is the double life of ours. Did you get my point? And if you wish, we can finish this subject. We can finish our lesson, our class. But if you have any question or problem, you can ask. Student Kane, maybe I can give another example. After that, I can finish, probably. Citizen Kane tells media owner's story. Media owners, you know. Following his death, a news reporter searches his life. In the movie, Charles Foster Kane has different and ambiguous personalities. Ambiguous. When he was a child, while sliding on his sled, he was taken to the city to be educated. His mother would like him to be educated properly, but Charles keeps seeing life a game world, and plays with everything, including his newspapers. Why? Because when he was a child, he was broken with his plays, with his toys. So while we are watching a movie, we are sometimes angry with Charles Foster Kane. Angry with, and sometimes have empathic feelings him. His ambiguity comes out at the ending of the scene of the movie. He encounters with crystal ball coming from his childhood, and he is shocked. You see his shock feeling on his face. After a while, he enters the mirror, and let me show this okay. This is the crystal image. Yes, he is taking the crystal ball, and it is coming from childhood. This crystal ball is coming from childhood. So it is pure memory, you know, it is pure memory, shining point. He is shocked. So he is divided person, as you see. You didn't see, but maybe I can show the last part of it again. You know, it is coming from the childhood, and he is recollecting the childhood memory. He is shocked. He is shocked, and after a while, he is entering the. Entering the mirror area, and when he enters the mirror area, you can see the divided person. There is a multiplicity of him. There can be different life of him. There could have been different life in his life, of his life, but it didn't happen. So this is the mirror scene. This is the mirror scene. You know, you see different personalities. Different personalities. This is the time image, crystal image. Cinema makes time visible. Charles childhood and maturity faces in front of the mirrors. Faces in encounters in front of mirrors. It is blur, you know, it is blurring of childhood and maturity.
So, okay. Is it that mirror is some sort of concept in cinema?
Mm-hmm.
Like mirror is used to depict time and recollection. And I want to get that straight.
Yes.
Okay, that's it.
That's it. But there are some minor points. I mean, detailed points,
yes.
And you generalize some points.
That is the core.
Yes, but you are right. Crystal image comes from mirror, but according to use mirror, you can create meanings. In a moment image cinema as well, mirrors could be used and was used, but in what context, in what meaning, in what way? But in time image cinema, mirror can be used like this in distinction between the actuality and virtuality, and you can benefit from mirror in order to show the different personalities of the people, and you can benefit from the mirror showing like the possibilities in life. Remember, I have given some examples. You could have gone to another faculty. You could have, you know, found another partner in life. But you realized one type of moment. So realizing, I mean, actualizing. And virtualizing is different from each other. But when you remember the different paths, different forks, you can think over the different possibilities in the life. So you can try to create or invent different life. I hope you received my point.
Yeah.
So in the next lesson, we will continue this subject. Actually, tomorrow.
Tomorrow, yeah.
Tomorrow. See you.